Capitalism is an economic system that has dominated the West for over 200 years. Yet every decade, capitalism is showing signs of age and does not respond to the ever-increasing change in the Western zeitgeist, culture, and people. The Great Recession and the retail apocalypse is a sign that capitalism is failing. Yet why does the globalized world and the West still hold on to it? Perhaps it is because capitalism is an Achilles heel to the system that we live under, and without it, the world will go up in flames, creating a world similar to Mad Max. Many generations have already invested in this fatalist reality, that life makes sense with capitalism, and there is no other better system. But that generation who instilled capitalism is dead, and the millennial and zoomer generations don't understand why they must live through a wage-cucking life. Capitalism was invented for the white, burly man who went out of the house to make himself a living, while the woman stays at home, takes care of the kids, while the man fights for his life. It required a certain ethos that is no longer existent in the West. Yet institutions, like PragerU and the Manosphere, want you to believe that being a masculine man is how you become successful in the West. Every decade that passes by, this is becoming false. Both the millennial and zoomer generations are redefining the so-called market and doubting the existence of capitalism by practicing nihilism and daydreaming nationalism. Millennials would rather act like fictional characters, acting like the cartoons they watch, and escape from the Midwest hell they must live under. Meanwhile, zoomers are those said cartoon characters millennials wanted to be, acting out life as if it was an anime that nobody is watching. This is antithetical to the white life that Gen Z and the boomer generations experienced. Capitalism is a game, and without its players, the game will stop functioning. The elite class has been invested in such ideals like Bernie Sanders' democratic socialism. But the problem of such a system is that it still advocates capitalism by spending more money on consumer culture and pretending capitalism does not exist. It's as if Sanders knows himself that capitalism cannot be defeated, so he uses fancy rhetoric and gives into the ideal that it is impossible to replace capitalism. Thus, capitalism has become a game, and is against the natural interest of nationalism, community, family, and the arts. Only human beings practice capitalism, and animals are only victims of it. It is hard to imagine that the West and the globalized world is eating the earth away based upon private property and simply a profit to extend one so-called freedom. The tradition of Western philosophy and the political left have tried so hard to create a system that could replace capitalism. Yet philosophy only subscribes to crony Marxism and egalitarianism as the only answers, and the left just agrees with it because it advocates rainbows, unicorns, and cupcakes of internal happiness. The best argument against fascism is the hip punk rock book Against the Fascist Creep by Alexander Reed Ross. Ross argues that fascism is a mistake created by the socialist, and a capitalist interpretation of socialism. This, however, divides the political left and right to have an internal war with one another, and solves nothing. We practice capitalism every day. I am practicing capitalism by brainwashing you, the consumer, to subscribe to my YouTube channel, and hopefully get in free donations and book sales from my dumb fans that want to believe a revolution is happening, or I am at least catering to their perverted desires. Capitalism needs a merchant exploiter and an obedient consumer. In capitalism, this is a necessary evil, but it is also the reason why no real revolution can happen, because money and consumer exploitation has distorted our views against humanity and the family. Ever since the creation of the experience economy, for 20 years, people have been buying services, or just products, that are about experiences than actual benefits to one's life. College, which was known as an intellectual and reputable source, has been dumbed down as a nice 4-year Disneyland vacation resort, where you have promiscuous sex with non-white girls, drink beer, smoke weed, and learn absolutely nothing, while the so-called intellectual professor swindles you of your money, while they act as a legit actor, creating a false belief you are actually learning anything. Money dictates all professions, and passion has been killed under capitalism. There is, however, a revolt in higher academia, where those losers and queers of capitalism are revolting against the system by creating work within higher academia. Therefore, they can make $60,000 or more a year teaching about anti-capitalism while they practice under it. This is why so many college professors are so-called Marxists because there is no other system that is being created to replace capitalism. This is not to say that academia is bad, but academia can create a cataclysm to revolt against the political left and right by advocating new philosophies that will replace capitalism. But isn't anti-capitalism just code for left-wing philosophy? No. The political right recently has failed to mention that capitalism is even an issue within their own ranks. And such movements, like the alt-right, have been infiltrated by trad thoughts and posers, like Emily Yukis and Illegal Aryan, who make money off the scene by exploiting off the weak Midwest nihilists who have no future. When approached with such claim, why do they hide behind a veneer of ideology? Because they too don't want to be outed as a capitalist exploiter. Popular touring musicians, bands, and artists know the game is rigged for capitalism, so they keep quiet about their sinful deeds and continue exploiting off the weak consumers who give them money. Because those consumers are not just stupid, but they envy their lives and have a fatalist view in life that they cannot change anything. When fans throw Super Chat money to Richard Spencer on heel turn, they say, it's for the cause. But in actuality, Richard Spencer is exploiting weak people so he can make a bourgeois living on his own. We all must practice this in capitalism, and I am too exploiting your time so I can get more famous in the YouTube quote-unquote content creator market. Just like Markiplier and Jacksepticeye. There is no denying we must practice capitalism as a necessary evil, and thus explains what the cultural left has been trying to do to combat such influences. Yet in such a classic anarchist book, like Days of War and Nights of Love, there is a segment which explains how being a part of consumer culture makes anarchists unaware they are actually practicing capitalism and not fighting for the revolution. In fact, the creation of normative values and the normie is based upon consumer exploitation and culture. Normative people who will rant against me that Richard Spencer is fighting for the white future are actually normative people under the spell of consumer exploitation. The concept of metapolitics fails when something should only be influenced under capitalism. This is exactly how Bernie Sanders and Donald Trump succeeded as politicians, selling the anti-capitalists that a future can be achievable, yet capitalism still prevails. Metapolitics under capitalism is a sad story that gets nowhere, like the career of David Duke. The only way out of capitalism is to start bringing it up in intellectual dialogue, then allowing it to become a product for it. The cultural Marxists tried to make anti-capitalist culture, but ended up creating an annoying and preening Hot Topic generation of blue-haired cat ladies who are actually exploited consumers. Life is becoming more like an anime. The millennials and zoomers are creating their own virtual reality, private property under capitalism. Something like what is happening in China. More spaces are created. And the right-wing concept of ethno-nationalism is referring to many worlds which the slightest differences, such as Eurasian people and mulatto gamers, need a virtual community to exist in. It becomes a reality that is post-capitalist, but advocates a human biodiversity world where peace happens because of separation and humanity progresses forward because our own materialistic and fantasized dreams are being realized through advanced technology. But again, cultural capitalism affects our attitudes. We determine what is hot and what is not, and it brings up important questions. Do we only desire to be with non-white girls on the fact it is a novelty, and that we are envious that other successful people have them? And are we only political because politics was a cool accessory that defined us? And finally, what if humanity and the West has a large democratic consensus that we wish that anime was real, and we will try anything through genetic engineering and through new cultural appropriation to reach that end goal? There is no denying the influence of capitalism, and we must apply it in our own discourse.